Michael Infante is with me in the studio today from One Media IP. Michael, good morning. Good to see you.
Thank you. Good to see you too.
Just to start with, give us an introduction here to One Media IP. You've been around since, or listed on AIM since 2014?
Correct. Prior to 2014, we listed on OFX in 2007. The object and the mission of the company is to acquire nostalgic music and video content. We've done that reasonably successful in the face of changing market and challenging times, and we now have over 250,000 music tracks in the library, 10,000 hours worth of video content. The music is predominantly content from the 1960s to about 1980s. The video content is an eclectic mix of everything from documentaries, music video, Sooty and Sweep, Skippy the Bush Kangaroo, and more recently Menna Motors that we acquired off of Granada ITV. In 2014, we moved from OFX to AIM, raised only £750,000 at that point. We were cash generative and have been. In fact, we've been paying dividends up until last year. We then acquired an interest in technical development. We in-house developed a product called TCAP, which we deployed across our own content to police our content across a legitimate music store such as Spotify and iTunes. And more recently now, we've announced this in a number of RNSs, we're now marketing that to the wider record industry, and we have two of the major record labels involved now in using our product to police their own content. So from policing our content to now working within the wider industry using our technology for other companies.
I suppose it's only just in recent times that, streaming's really taken off, quite a big market now.
Yeah. Pre-2012, really, there was no money in it at all. I've been a big fan of streaming because typically the music market is a short market of window of interest for consumers. You tend to buy music from age 13, 14 years old. By the time you're 21, 22, you used to stop buying, and maybe you started getting, you know, the Father's Day, Mother's Day recompilations of your content. With the advent of subscription, by the time you license your mobile phone or whatever it is, you're suddenly roped into a $7.99 or $8.99 monthly subscription, and so it's fill your boots with as much content. Now, this is either subscription or ad-funded, and that's really spawned the growth that we've seen in the last 18 months back into the music industry. And this is just the beginning, because we've seen a massive drop-off. If we think about the music industry in 2002, it was taking $42 billion. Last year, or I think it was a year ending 2016, it took $16 billion. But there have been more music transactions in the last 5 years than there ever were back in the 60s, 70s and 80s. Now, monetizing those transactions is what's happening with streaming, and therefore most of the clever people now are looking at it and saying there is a return back to those $30 and $40 billion days. It may be 10 years away, but it's only going one way.
So some of these music tracks, programs, they're available on Spotify, YouTube and the like?
All of our music content is available through 600 digital stores. It's about 60 different brands from Spotify, Amazon, Deezer, Google Play, all of the regular products that you'll be familiar with. Our video content, we've only really just mastered working with YouTube, because you could only monetize it over the last few years. So all of our creative technicians are YouTube accredited. They have to do an annual exam, say in best practices, so that we can sort of squeeze out the best that we can out of monetizing it through ad-funded models. Of course, there are more channels breaking through now as the monetization of streaming is going to get stronger and stronger. And whether it's Vevo, Vimeo, or Qello, or any of these other emerging sites, we're going to see loads, loads more. And that's putting to side Netflix and Amazon, the biggies. You know, there'll be loads, loads more of these channels. You buy a smart TV now, when you turn it on, the number of apps that appear on your screen, you can begin to see where the new monetization of video and audio is going to come. Audible also, which is an Amazon spoken word service, is another growing area for us. A lot of the content we've bought, we can separate the audio from the video and create spoken word content. So that again is something new. It's in its infancy, but it's something that we're putting time into to create content for. Where we've got spoken word, and we have the rights to do so, we can transcribe the spoken word into written word and create paperback books through the Amazon print on demand service. And so this year we've just started, I think we've created about 20 or 30 paperback books from spoken word content. And for the first time, they're back available as paperbacks, which is crazy. It's a bit like LPs making a return. Paperbacks now on print on demand is an easy way for companies like us to produce written content as well as just using it in the audio format.
An easy way, you say, but an opportunity to be had there.
Indeed, absolutely. Previously not existed. And I suppose it's only the technology in the last 3 years that allows this. So whilst we were putting and buying content over the last 10 years, even 10 years ago, I'd say that we didn't even know what the opportunities would be for all of that content. And that's true now, perhaps looking forward to the next 10 years. I think there's going to be a lot of avenues to market that perhaps we don't even know about yet where content can be exploited.
You mentioned you were paying a dividend up until last year.
Yes,
last year. How come you put the brakes on that?
Well, we saw a drop in our turnover and we saw a drop in our profitability. This was largely due to the change in the way people consume the format of music. Predominantly it was downloading. Then we saw the drop of downloading and streaming coming back. Well, those, if it was a graph, you saw downloading going like this and streaming sort of coming up here. It's only this year that it's crossed. So now streaming is picking up the drop off where downloading occurred. Similarly, about 10 years ago, you had the same thing with CD sales dropping off and downloading. But the new formats don't pick up the slack as fast as perhaps the old formats drop off. So we rose a little bit of a roller coaster, dropped back 35% over the last 3 years. Now we're back on the curve, growing back up again.
And a big year ahead, you're looking forward to it?
Absolutely, yes. We've got a lot of ambitions to fulfill. We've recently announced a new investment into the company from Lord Grade and Ivan Dunleavy. Proposed NED positions for them moving forward at some stage. And RI very much on looking at publishing.
And what, a little bit further down the track, what is the big ambition for One Media IP?
I think we, at the moment, are in a unique position. We've got the technical service of our product called TCATS. We have video exploitation and we have audio exploitation. I think we can be not necessarily a fully rounded entertainment company, but I think we can be an entertainment company or a content service company with technical services. So I think we're carving a new niche for ourselves in terms of the way the industry is going, and the industry is changing more rapidly than anyone can really ever understand. 90 years of music purchasing on physical formats really is now coming to an end. Globally, last year we saw tipping the 50% mark of sales going into digital formats away from physical. And even with the sort of latest resurgence of vinyl, it's more of a niche content. It's a collectible, not necessarily, you're not going to suddenly see 7-inch records appearing in cars and in car players because it's not practical. So the content exploitation world that we're moving into now, I think, is an interesting one and going to be a very interesting spot moving forward.
And it's quite a highly acquisitive business that you've got.
Yeah, in the past, we've made lots of very small acquisitions, ranging from the smallest at $3,000 up to the biggest at $1.6 million. But we've made over 180 of them, which is how we end up with a quarter of a million music tracks and all the video, because we're often buying directly from the labels, the small indie labels, the artists, the artist management, or even estates of deceased artists. And we're making deals that suit them. Sometimes we buy it outright, sometimes we license it, sometimes it's a revenue share deal. So we kind of become a little bit of an aggregator as much as an acquisitor. But it works then for the partners that we're working with, and we report well, we have to. We're in the copyright enforcement business. So, the last thing we want to do is to upset our partners. But it does give the artists and the partners of previous an opportunity not to sell out and participate in the growth of the business moving forward.
And how do you typically fund these acquisitions?
So far, we've been very good. We've been doing it out of profits and out of resource. We have had two small raises in the 10 years, but it equals to a top end of about 1.5 million over 10 years. So most of the acquisitions we've done out of resource. We have no debt. We're debt free. And I think last time I looked at the balance sheet, we had about £4.5 to 5 million worth of asset at cost. We haven't revalued that. Perhaps one day we should, but my accountant will now kill me.
Really good to see you, Michael. Thanks very much.
Thank you.